everybody. My name is Anne-Marie. I'm Acting Director of Studies here at Atlantic Language, and I'm delighted to be here. So, we'll just jump straight in. And this disappears. So, I'm going to have a little bit of a confession time today. Bare my soul, confess my sins in terms of communication. Starting straight in at the deep end, talking about some of my communication breakdowns and giving some concrete examples. And then I'll go on to discuss the what, the why, the how, the theme of the conference, indeed, of communication. Then again, a bit technical, looking at the functional, interpretivist, and critical approaches to communication. Because I think, having done a tiny bit of research, dipping my toe in the water, I found they actually have something to say in some of the problems I've encountered as a newly recruited Director of Studies here. And then I'll go back to my initial problems, give some ideas of how I've coped with, some solutions I've come up with, and some perspectives I've gained from having looked at the functional, interpretivist, and critical approaches. So, confession time. So, in the different communication breakdowns I've asked myself, okay, how have I transmitted this message? Why has there been a breakdown? What am I not getting across? Why is it that I thought the teacher or the student was listening to me, but later it emerged it wasn't? And I, in the spirit of being a teacher, I brought some reality with me. So we have exhibit A. You all know what this is. A beautiful, perfectly kept register. So beautiful, she's color-coded. We have exhibit B. Probably one we're more familiar with. Now, there are a myriad number of problems stemming from this register. For immigration, we don't have the attendance. For the teacher coming in to cover, what do I do? What lesson do I do? But we have an exhibit C. Take the picture. And here we have a problem that occurred in August. A full class, we have a name on the top of the register. What does that mean? Student going into the wrong class. Teacher not communicating that to me. The student not communicating it to me. Instead going to the agent. I get the letter. I get the agent's letter. Maybe the following week. Maybe a month. Maybe last week. So I communicate to the teachers. Please, if a student goes in, not on the register, don't allow them in. This has been a constant with me. Luckily, eventually it got through, and then this teacher, as you'll see, checked a new register, and actually she found the student. So it does get through. It doesn't always get through. And my question, how, I repeated at teacher's meeting, how is this not getting through? I asked myself, what is it I'm not communicating properly here? So parking, leaving that aside for a minute, we'll move on to the what, the why, and the how. So we'll start with a simple definition of what is communication. And it's communication is the process by which information is transmitted and understood. Well, we know that's a bit problematic because it's not always transmitted accurately. It's not always understood. So I like the behaviorist definition, which sees communication as a symbolic process by which individuals act to exchange perceptions and ultimately build a knowledge bank for themselves. It recognizes that it's perceptions that we are exchanging and not ultimately building that knowledge bank. So why do we communicate? To get things done, to bring about change. Another why we will see, George Pinkney referred to 95% of the time we spend on communication. A study by Mintzberg in 1973 found that in that particular study, managers spent 80% of the time in information transmission activities. And then the how, well, we transmit verbally, non-verbally, and written. Phone, face-to-face, notices. And all that non-verbal, and you're probably all familiar with this, 55% of that is transmitted non-verbally, 38% by the tone of voice, and only 70% by the words used. So you have to be so careful of what you're transmitting, the non-verbal message that you're sending. So in a face-to-face communication, talking to a teacher, am I transmitting non-verbally the seriousness of this message? Is it the suggestion, or is it, yes, I really wanted to do that? Another how is the channels of communication we use. And Nadine mentioned the face-to-face. Management texts emphasise that it's so important not to underestimate the complex interconnections that we can form in unanticipated face-to-face encounters. So this could be traditional water cooler exchange, or going into the staff room, chatting with the staff as you do, building that trust to facilitate and improve your communication with them. It also allows for the maximum amount of information to be transmitted. So you've got the non-verbal, but you can also see the reaction. It's a two-way process. Media richness theorists suggest that we should match the media with the message. So the more ambiguous the message, the more scope for misinterpretation, the more rich the media should be, face-to-face, for example. So think about what media do you choose to transmit your messages? A new staff meeting, is it a notice, or do you go around individually to each teacher and tell them? The medium matches what it is. Again, the medium is the message. Marshall McLuhan's medium and the message tells us that the medium we choose transmit more information than the word, the content itself. Not more information, it transmits the message beyond the words itself. So again, if you get a formal letter and head of notepaper from the company stamped, that's very formal. That sends you a message even before you read the letter. If you have a face-to-face, yes, it allows for all that information, but it might be interpreted as informal and not really at all. The lens metaphor is perceptions. It recognises that communication is selectively perceived. We don't always receive all the information. And I think that's useful to remember when you reflect on why some of the communication isn't as successful as we want. And listening. A plethora of studies from 1930 to 2006 all find the majority of our communication activities, the large proportion of those are listening, whether it's in work, in school, in play, in interaction. One of them in particular, conducted by the US Department of Labor in 1991, found managers spent 55% of their time in listening activities in the communication. In 1995, Hassan Arland found that listening was perceived as an important component in communicative competence, and furthermore, that individual competence was judged to be directly related to listening ability or perceived listening effectiveness. So how you perform as a listener reflects on your performance as an individual in the company. So now moving on to the functional. The functional school of thought on communication sees communication as a metaphorical pipeline. So there is a sender and a receiver. Information goes through one way, very linear. Functional sees communication, the purpose of it is to control, motivate, and inform your workers. It may seem a little harsh. And it sees organizations as containers in which people work and goods and services are provided. There's a communication as a mechanistic view of information flow where there are prescribed routes and defined content. So imagine your management chart where you have the manager, the managing director at the top, teachers at the bottom. This will give you an indication of the information flow, communication flow. Who can communicate with who? In what direction? It's usually downwards, as I've mentioned, not upwards. We'll come back to that again. Also, this school of thought saw communication and information flow as discrete things, that these could be investigated within the organizational container in order to increase productivity. So it saw overall the metaphor was machine, predictable, communication was predictable, flowing in certain pathways. In reaction to this, and maybe something I prefer more, is the interpretivist school of thought. And this saw a conceptual shift from mechanistic to a constitutive view. So from the metaphor of the machine to the metaphor of the organism. So it saw communication as something that exists in the workplace, that is, rather than something that manages the workplace. So it recognized, what's particularly illuminating and relevant, I think, about this is that it underlined the unpredictability of human behavior. How you might give the message to this room, everyone will react in a different way, you cannot predict. So it's not as robotic as the functionalist school of thought, it recognizes people will react in different ways. It goes back again to the lens metaphor, the idea of selective perception, and how it's so important to choose the right medium for our communication. Moving on to the critical, the final one. We saw the critical definition of communication when they're looking at the what of communication. And the critical school of thought studied communication in terms of hidden exercises of power and managerial influence. The metaphors of voice and discourse allows you to study who is allowed to speak, to whom, and in what way. So again, you go back to that chart. Who is allowed to speak to whom? The managing director? Maybe can speak to the lowly employee, but can the lowly employee initiate that contact? And what? So the expression or suppression of voice is one way that communication is seen within this school of thought. What is interesting is a global study done by the International Association of Business Communicators, which highlighted the need for organizations to make significant changes in how they communicated with their employees in order to connect with them, in order to give them a voice. There's been references by Nadine, I think, in George in terms of the feedback, and Nadine in terms of the sessions where you allow the teachers to have a participation in the project, involvement. This is something that was highlighted by this study. Respondents said they wanted the opportunity to give feedback, to collaborate, and actively contribute to their organisation. And I think this is maybe something we miss sometimes. In my problems, in the registers, maybe I can say in the meeting, how do we deal with this? Teachers, they have the best ideas. They are on the ground. How can we give them a voice? Maybe it's problematic to implement, but is it worth considering? So to move on. So to go back to my communication breakdowns, and I think it's worth to go back and see what are those problems and to analyse them through the lens metaphor. Maybe the information is incomplete. It's being selectively perceived. Maybe my non-verbal communication of the message is giving a different message. So I rush into the staff room. I say, can you teach this class? Okay, yeah. Rush out. The teacher doesn't turn up to the class. Why? I didn't properly communicate that message. I didn't properly communicate the message that is so important to check your register. I have to, how am I communicating? Spend that moment of focus, as you said, George, 30 seconds of focus on that person without thinking, what am I to do next? And that is where it's important to remember your nonverbal communication. And what media do I choose to transmit? Do I do the face-to-face, which is great, it may be perceived as informal. Do I do both? Do I back it up? In a meeting recently, I concept checked. What is the register? What happens if a student goes into the class? It worked, but the next week the problem came up again. It has to be repeated. Which students, as I said at the outset, a problem was they were going directly to the agent. So I initiated this process around the time when I was first asked to speak at this conference, so I started self-reflecting. Right, on Mondays I'm going around to each class. I'm introducing myself. I'm telling them where they can come and meet me. Instead of them coming to me, I'm going to meet them. I introduce them to some of the procedures. You'll get your book tomorrow, the level change test. Yeah. It also gives me the opportunity to get non-verbal feedback from them. They're sitting there like that. There might be a problem. They kind of look confused. Maybe I can follow up on that. It also gives them the opportunity to ask questions to me. Equally, on the Friday, if I'm going to merge a class, open the class, and they'll be changed, I go and explain it. I usually say, good news, your class, is going to be smaller. You're going to be, I'm rearranging the class so the nationalities will be mixed. Explain to them why. And I have to say, now I haven't done any serious research on this, there have been fewer complaints. There have been fewer emails from the agents. And any email I have got have been reflecting back to the time before I implemented this. That's not to say it will never happen. In a feedback form last week from a student who will be nameless, he said, he wrote, sometimes our task has changed and I don't know why. This is strange, the student, he's communicated with me a lot. Maybe he's not in that Friday. Maybe he's hungover, but maybe he doesn't get that message. So I'm not saying it will always work. But I just found the need to repeat, reach out, and try to initiate as much communication and revisit as often as I can. So moving on to my next slide, which is, any questions? Any questions?
Thank Anne-Marie for the talk. To meet the there and deal with any questions that come up.
Just before I finish, I have a list of the references of any bold and rash statements I've made in the talk. So if anyone wants, I can pass those around.
But if there are any questions, it's okay to take from me. Is there anybody who has a question about that?
I just wondered in relation to the filling in of registers,
yeah,
with others. I very often find in our context as teachers that it's often one person who is not doing it continuously. So therefore, I kind of find the effectiveness of delivering it in a general meeting,
yeah,
because the individual who's not filling in the register,
yeah,
is thinking, oh, she's talking to all of us.
Yeah.
So obviously, I'm not the only one,
yeah,
who doesn't fill in the register.
Yeah.
And then the individual who's doing was like, I'm hearing this again.
Yeah, yeah.
I often feel that maybe managers are afraid to approach individuals
directly,
no conversation.
And also, perhaps it's time consuming, you know, but
yeah.
I just wonder if you've come across that, you know.
Yeah, but yeah, in terms of that, I will deal with the particular teachers one-on-one in as light a way as possible.
Mm-hmm.
And yes, the filling in the register is one thing. My more serious concern was students going into the class,
mm-hmm,
and on the register as well. I deal with that individually, but I think it's also important to keep repeating it so that it does get through.
Mm-hmm.
But you're right, yeah. There is, it often is one offender. Mm-hmm. Thank you for...
Depending on the context within that particular team and the relationships you all have, you could consider naming and shaming as well.
Yeah.
It depends,
yeah,
on the relationships
there
and
is.
How it's all set up, but that could be effective too.
Yeah, I mean... Yeah, that is an idea. I mean, there is often a guy who will stand up and say, yeah, I know it was me, but
yeah,
you know, I'm just terrible at paperwork.
So you can wear it as a badge of honour on something.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm creative, though.
Yeah.
You know, people who are beyond performance.
Yeah,
yeah. And these are all excellent teachers who do an excellent job, you know. So, I hasten to add that.
Thank you very much, Anne-Marie.
Thank you.